Tonight, from 5 to 24, elderly abuse claims explode at a scandal-hit Nedlands nursing home. The investigation now expanded. Plus, the Premier blast Fremantle's tent city organisers as ego trippers, telling the homeless to step up as the clock ticks on their temporary accommodation. The tragic twist in a deadly Langford crash, a young mother killed, thrown from her car. Tonight, the first responders who tried to save her life. The man who asked all the right questions. Talk show royalty Larry King dies aged 87 after a COVID battle. And a jumbo-sized celebration for Perth Zoo's much-loved matriarch, Trisha the Elephant, defying the odds, turning 64.
This is Nine News Perth with Gerry DeMassey.
Good evening. There are fears tonight the number of abuse allegations at a Nedlands nursing home is growing. Relatives have told Nine News the facility's management has expanded its probe into serious mistreatment claims, and the number is now in the dozens.
Fran Veltman's mother suffers dementia, but for some reason was drawn to this pamphlet during a recent visit.
For the first time ever, she stopped at a rack and she pulled out a little pamphlet that said, "Do you have a complaint?" and handed it to me.
The 87-year-old, one of the Regis residents at the centre of shocking mistreatment claims. Families told by management yesterday the investigation is expanding, up from 5 incidents to 24, now involving a possible 18 residents on 3 separate wards at the Nedlands facility.
When I heard that, I thought, well, this is a really systemic issue. It's not just, you know, one bad egg.
The Major Crime Squad is investigating 2 deaths possibly related to alleged abuse after claims of rough handling, aggressive staff, sexually inappropriate behaviour and understaffing. Regis not revealing the exact nature of the new incidents, only to tell relatives they're just as worrying.
And those were the kind of incidents we're talking about. Category 1, the most serious kinds of incidents that should always be reported.
Fran Veltman says she doesn't even know the full extent of her own mother's alleged abuse, calling for Regis to be more transparent, put on more carers and guarantee medication will only be handed out by nurses.
If there is a broader scale issue that needs to be addressed, then obviously an inquiry would be a good way to go about that, but we do need to wait and see what's happened there.
For Fran Veltman, the wait for answers is already too long.
It's getting to the point now where I'm desperately thinking about how could I get enough money to have a full-time carer here 24/7 to bring her home.
We asked for a response from Regis management today and were initially told they couldn't comment due to privacy concerns. We also reached out to Advocare, which is right now assisting and offering support for both residents and staff. They say they'll provide an update on the situation within 24 hours. Gerry, we know the criminal investigation is continuing, but whether these new incidents fall under that probe is unclear.
Jacqueline Robson, thank you. Mark McGowan has told WA's homeless to step up if they want to be given somewhere to live. Nearly 70 people from Fremantle's tent city are spending their second night in hotels across Perth, but they could be back on the streets in days.
Their tents down, WA's homeless now put up in hotels. But it's only a 1-week stay on offer, and after that, Mark McGowan says they'll have to find somewhere else to sleep, just not Pioneer Park in Fremantle.
People need to also step up, and they need to be prepared to work with the agencies and do the right thing.
The Premier today calling tent city organisers ego trippers.
We got reports that people were being pulled out of supported accommodation on promises by the organisers they would get people a house immediately. Whilst they're in the camp and they're being encouraged by the organisers of the camp to stay there, it was very difficult.
I worry that in the case of what's happened at Pioneer Park, that the can is just being kicked down the road and that we aren't addressing the systemic and complex issues.
That issue feared to get even worse when the rental moratorium ends in March, making it legal for landlords to evict problem tenants again. The current rental shortage already making it hard and expensive for any tenant to find a home. Right now, there are 36,000 public houses in WA, homing more than 60 64,000 people, but the wait times are ever growing.
The Premier says he's investing $1 billion to the cause. That's in addition to the $100 million already spent housing people in remote Aboriginal communities.
The priority list wait time has halved since we came to office, so we're managing those people on the priority list far more quickly and far more effectively.
But perhaps not quick enough for the at least 67 tent city evictees tonight in emergency accommodation, who by the end of the week could be homeless again. Kelly Haywood, Nine News.
A young mother has been killed in a horror crash in Langford, the impact throwing her from her car. First responders tried desperately to help the 27-year-old Liv, who was just 5 minutes from home.
A late-night journey home that claimed the life of a young mother, Kimi Waka, just minutes from her home.
I just was, like, screaming and crying and just, like, pumping and trying to get her to breathe.
Kimi Waka was driving along Nicholson Road in Langford when she lost control of her car. The Suzuki hatch mounting the median strip, slamming into a tree and throwing her metres across the road.
As all the windows were out, the exhaust from underneath the car was beside the car. There was a baby seat in the back of the car, just pretty much all the airbags were out, like it was, the car was just gone. So you could only imagine what happened to the girl from there on without having to see it.
We don't want to show you the identity of these three teenagers because of their age. The trio, first on scene and after witnessing the horrific crash, tried to revive the 27-year-old.
I kept, like, pushing and, like, I just kept going until, like, the police got there, and then the police got there and they took over for a bit, and that's when they realised she was dead. But, like, I didn't even want to look at her once I seen her because, like, it shocked me.
In a tragic twist, the first responders found out just hours ago they actually know the family of the woman they were trying to save. Today, the 27-year-old's partner remembered Kimi as the most beautiful person he's ever met, saying, "It kills me inside knowing we can't experience our milestones together."
You can still see the tyre marks and parts of the car here today, but Major Crash is still investigating exactly how this happened, urging anyone with dash cam footage to come forward.
Lucy McLeod, Nine News.
To breaking news now, and a fire at a battery store in Perth South East has triggered explosion fears. The blaze started just before 5 o'clock at the Battery World in Maddington, just metres away from a petrol station. Crews quickly contained the flames, forcing entry into the Albany Highway business. Firefighters are still on scene, making sure that the area is safe. A rock climber has been winched to safety after falling metres down a cliff in the Great Southern. Kelly Haywood, he was trapped for 2 hours.
Jerry, he was. SES crews managed to pull the man to safety, carrying him back up the rocks on a stretcher. It's understood he was rock climbing near the popular tourist destination The Gap in Albany, and police say the 25-year-old fell 8 metres just before 2 this afternoon. Emergency crews were called to the Torn Deer Up National Park, and the emergency RAC chopper dispatched. He's now at Albany Regional Hospital being treated for his leg injuries, and Jerry, tonight he's in a stable condition.
Kelly, thank you. WA's hard border with New South Wales and Queensland will ease from midnight tonight. Travellers will no longer need an exemption to enter, but will still have to self-quarantine for 14 days and get a COVID test on day 11. One traveller who is still unsure if he'll be visiting, though, is the Prime Minister, Scott Morrison, refusing to commit to joining opposition leader Zach Kirkup in the lead-up to the WA election.
No one would expect that the Prime Minister or any other individual from over east is given special treatment just for an election campaign.
Both Queensland and New South Wales have had more than a week of no locally transmitted cases, now joining Victoria as low-risk areas. The Pfizer COVID vaccine is expected to be signed off on by the regulator this week, but the Treasurer insisting deliveries are on track for a February arrival. A multi-million dollar ad campaign will be launched in the coming weeks, aimed to convince us all to get the jab.
The Treasurer takes his hat off to small business hit hard by COVID. He's cautiously optimistic about the economic recovery, but a successful vaccine is seen as key, and there are still bumps to overcome. The Therapeutic Goods Administration is expected to give the Pfizer jab the tick of approval this week, but there have been supply issues in Europe. The Prime Minister has warned that could affect the rollout timetable here.
We're on track to receive The Pfizer vaccine mid to late February.
Once COVID-19 vaccines are available, GPs will be able to bulk bill the jabs, and the government is confident Australians will line up. New figures show the vast majority of parents have their children vaccinated. Rates among five-year-olds above the target of 95%.
It reflects the capacity of Australia to very successfully immunise the population more broadly, and also the faith that people have in the TGA and our health systems.
To hammer the message home, a huge ad campaign is expected to be launched assuring safety. From ad campaigns to election campaigns, the Treasurer was today playing down speculation the government will go to the polls by the end of the year.
The election is due in 2022.
If it's early, it's because Scott Morrison doesn't have the confidence in his own government to be able to last a three-year term.
Kerry Yaxley, Nine News.
A 68-year-old marine scientist owes his life to his quick-thinking wife after he was attacked by a shark in a New South Wales lake. Despite several sightings, there hasn't been an attack at Lake Macquarie in decades, but locals say it was only a matter of time.
His arm so badly mauled he might never use it again, but Rick Burberry is being treated with careful hands. A rescue crew used to the unexpected, but in the calm waters of Lake Macquarie, no one was prepared for this.
Yeah, it was pretty horrific, just sitting around having a beer and heard some distressing yells and screaming.
Pulled out by his wife Julie, a doctor, and right beside the couple, Wollongong lifeguard Matt Lumby, on holiday, but always on alert.
We've noticed the guy getting thrashed around the water. Bit of a moaning and a bit of a scream. I was yelling out as I was dragging to bystanders to someone get me a belt.
Someone grabbed a belt for me, yeah, and I just had to run it down.
A horrible sight, and he was very conscious. He was just laying right on the edge of the water, and his wife was keeping him alive, really.
Awake and able to talk when paramedics arrived.
He indicated the shark was as long as he's tall and he would be a six-foot gentleman. He'd been treated by bystanders with some makeshift first aid, which has probably saved his life.
DPI officials are right now working with police to identify the type of shark and whether there's any further risk.
The description of the shark we had was a broad nose, brown.
Rick Burberry is in John Hunter Hospital, supported by his wife. It's understood the marine scientist could lose his left arm. Ruth Wynne-Williams, Nine News.
With a career spanning six decades and upwards of 50,000 interviews under his belt, Larry King was a legend of screen and radio. The broadcaster has passed away in Los Angeles weeks after being diagnosed with COVID-19.
My name is Larry King.
King by name, King by reputation, with a gift for getting the most out of his guests, like reclusive actor Marlon Brando.
I'm going to make him an offer he can't refuse.
Darling. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
From movie stars to presidents and everything in between.
You wore both war braces in my honour.
That's right, we certainly did. We wanted to, just because you always wear these things.
In a 63-year career, Larry King interviewed more than 50,000 guests across radio, TV and online.
I'm a feminist. I've been a feminist all my life.
That's fantastic.
It's still a good word.
Yes, it's not the F word.
Why did you come to this program? I mean, I'm glad you came.
No, because you asked me to come and I haven't seen you in a long time to begin with. I thought we ought to get together and chat.
But he wasn't always a king. Born Lawrence Ziegler in Brooklyn during the Great Depression, he moved to Miami as an office boy at a local radio station. He turned talk show host and eventually switched to TV in 1985 when CNN launched Larry King Live.
We hope that you enjoy this kind of alternative to primetime programming rather than murder, mayhem, sex, violence. We'll bring you all of those, but disguised.
One of his regular guests once filled in for him.
I'm Donald Trump, sitting in for Larry tonight.
Trump was a great guest because he was a character, but president, I never thought of him as president.
In 1987, he discussed the presidency with then-Senator Joe Biden.
You didn't think you wanted it. In fact, I even wrote it in the column. You didn't want it because you had young kids.
You were a revolutionary. Were you a terrorist? Did you ever commit acts of aggression, violence?
Well, terrorism depends on...
Who wins?
That's right.
Larry King became so famous, he played himself in more than 60 movies and TV shows.
Thanks for being with us, Palmer. You have had quite a ride this last couple of years.
Yeah, I sure have, Larry.
His style, non-confrontational, it earned him an Emmy Award and countless friendships. Tributes flowing when news broke that Larry King had died overnight in an LA hospital. Bill Clinton tweeting he'd been interviewed by King more than 20 times. Today he said, "Farewell, my friend." Oprah saying it was always a treat to sit at your table and hear your stories. Thank you, Larry King. Married 8 times, Larry King suffered personal tragedies, losing 2 children last year. He also battled serious heart trouble, diabetes, prostate and lung cancer, and earlier this month he was hospitalised with coronavirus. His family asking for privacy while a memorial is planned. Larry King was 87 years old.
I don't know what to say except to you, my audience. Thank you. And instead of goodbye, how about so long?
In Los Angeles, Michael Genovese, 9 News.
Perth Zoo's favourite resident has been thrown a jumbo-sized celebration. Trisha the elephant turning the grand old age of 64, exceeding her life expectancy by more than a decade.
A grand entrance for a grand lady.
Oh, you are beautiful.
Perth Zoo's much-loved matriarch celebrating her 64th year with a fruity cake and plenty of peanut butter. Trisha arrived in Perth from Vietnam in 1963, quickly becoming a family favourite.
Oh, she's beautiful, yeah. We come and see her every couple of months.
I think she's really nice and kind.
The Asian elephant, now one of the oldest in the country.
It's a massive feat for us to get it to this age. They normally live around 40 to 50, so this is actually extra special for us.
The birthday girl may be showing her age, but she's still as cheeky as ever.
She knows how to manipulate, as you can hear her. She loves her keepers more than anything, so that's actually a happy noise with her.
Her secret to staying that way, a daily pampering of massages and skin oilings.
When Trisha does eventually pass away, it'll signal the end to the zoo's elephant exhibition, making every final moment all the more precious.
It's all about her quality of life. We just want to make sure that she's comfortable in her twilight years.
Louise Rennie, 9 News.
And isn't she looking fantastic? Also looking fantastic, Elizabeth Creasy's here with weather, Liz. A bit of summer rain in the suburbs.
Well, thank you, Jerry. Yes, we did have a few drops of rain around this morning when some dark clouds moved in from the west, but not enough to actually register anything in the gauges around the city. Just 0.2 millimetres was recorded at Garden Island around midday. And with that southerly wind blowing for most of last night, we have recorded our coldest minimum so far this year, 15.9 degrees at 5:30 this morning. And our maximum of 27.1 is our second coolest of this month. Inland, that decaying tropical low is continuing to move further southeast, dumping some pretty heavy falls through central WA. In the 24 hours to 9 a.m, 44 millimetres was recorded at Warburton and 20 at Giles. Now, we have got a couple more cool days like this to enjoy before the heat returns at the end of the week. I'll have the forecast a little later, Jerry.
Thanks, Liz. We'll see you soon. Coming up, WA police numbers set to swell. Why the new recruitment drive aims to bring in a record number of cadets. Plus, the hunt for a runaway driver in an East Perth crash. A stolen luxury car rams vehicles inside a busy shopping centre car park. And should parents be allowed to pack school lunch? Why experts say supplied food would be much healthier. The WA Police Force is on the hunt for more officers to patrol Perth streets in the biggest recruitment drive in its history. It's hoped the multi-million dollar ad campaign will add a record number of frontline officers.
Real recruits.
Every day, we put on the uniform.
On the beat.
From then on, anything can happen.
It's this $1.8 million ad campaign Mark McGowan hopes will lure in hundreds of extra police officers to keep WA safe.
We want to make sure that the West Australian Police is diverse and experienced.
October's state budget included a $314 million boost to find 800 new cops. This ad campaign, Let's Join Forces, aims to do just that. It's the biggest police recruitment drive in WA history.
We've never been better equipped in terms of our technology. Our officers have never been better supported in terms of their protection. And now we're adding significantly to our West Australian police force.
The jobs push comes after a drop in major crimes late last year. Homicides down 10%, assaults down by 9%. Robberies dropping from 93 a month to 79. But the total offences for September up 2.4%, with officers attending an average of an extra 12 jobs every day. Former council ranger Karina Piahana, now officially the newest member of the WA police force.
I wanted to help and make a difference in my community, but also it was really important for me to be able to be a positive representation of women and for people of my culture.
The 28-year-old, part of the four-year recruitment drive, focused on diversity.
If you think you've got what it takes to be a police officer, then there's a job here for you.
Kelly Haywood, Nine News.
Police are tonight on the hunt for a runaway driver who fled the scene of a crash in East Perth. Emergency crews were called to East Parade around 2:30 this morning to find the driver and passenger had fled the scene. The smash caused significant damage to a CCTV power box near the Graham Farmer Freeway. A heartbroken family and a sporting community are in shock tonight after a man was killed by a charging bull. 62-year-old Bruce Green was volunteering at a rodeo in country New South Wales when he was attacked tonight. He's being remembered as a diamond in the rough.
It is, by any measure, a dangerous sport. Certainly for the riders and those trying to protect them, not usually for officials. Bruce Greeny Green from Grafton was a long-time member of the sport, well-known and well-liked. At a rodeo and camp draft event last night, he was charged by a bull in what's been described as a freak accident. A volunteer, he was dealing with stock away from the main ring. He was treated at the scene for critical injuries but later died at Tamworth Hospital. In a touching tribute, the Australian Bushmen's Camp Draft and Rodeo Association said Greeny has always been there, always part of the rodeo, a great bloke and diamond in the rough. You'll be sadly missed by us all. A report is now being prepared for the coroner. Eddie Meyer, Nine News.
A stolen Audi has smashed into a car in a car park north of Brisbane while it was being pursued by police. As the driver dodged officers, he crashed into the side of a Mazda and backed into a ute before racing onto the road. A 22-year-old man was arrested 2 hours later. Parents have long packed their children's school lunches, but researchers believe that needs to change. They say schools should be in charge of the lunchbox to make sure it's a healthy one.
It's the scene of some big daily decision-making. What goes in the school lunchbox?
Variety is the problem, I think.
In the Orrick family household, twins Jaden and Dylan aren't fussy eaters, but they both have preferences.
Normally, just like a silver side sandwich or a ham sandwich.
For lunch, I like salads.
It's a stressful task, and for many, sometimes, convenience trumps nutrition.
Some fruit in there, you know, something substantial, high-fibre meals. But they also like snacks, like chips, lollies and things like that.
But what if parents are freed of the routine of packing lunch? Researchers at Flinders University are looking into whether lunches provided by schools would improve children's diets.
We think that would be really good around some of the food insecurity challenges we face here in Australia, but also a solution to help really busy parents.
The research team has found 40% of the energy consumed by kids at school is from unhealthy food. Under a school-provided lunch model, students would have access to more nutritious options, like in childcare.
We actually just really want to take the good practice that kids are already used to in childcare and see how that could be translated into the school setting.
Yeah, I will be supportive of that. I don't think it would be something you could do every single day.
Lunches provided by schools isn't a radical idea. It exists all over the world in countries like the US, the UK and Japan. It would require the backing of government. The next step of their research will look at the economics.
We're trying to understand all of the costs so that we can make the case of why this is a worthwhile investment.
Then it would take pressure off of them and then they could focus what really matters in life.
Mike Lorigan, Nine News.
Lots of parents at home agreeing with that, I'm sure. What's in store for the Australia-US relationship? Our ambassador reveals what he expects from the Biden presidency. That's next. Plus, the Treasurer hits back at Google after it threatens to withdraw its search engine from Australia. The man dubbed the El Chapo of the East, taken into custody after a global manhunt, and the best Aussie Rubik's Cube Masters battle it out. China, climate change and trade deals. The Morrison government has laid bare its priorities for the new US administration. And Australia's ambassador in Washington is straight to work with Joe Biden's team after a tumultuous 12 months navigating COVID, riots and Donald Trump.
1 year into the job.
There she is.
Ambassador, how are you?
Good to see you.
Ambassador Arthur Sinodinos, fresh from a front row seat to Joe Biden's inauguration.
I've already had some good interactions with senior people in the White House who are relevant to Australia, and we're very keen to get on with things.
A new administration, new challenges, new relationships. What are you looking forward to?
Well, a lot of them we know because they were in the Obama administration. They've got strong principles they're going to bring to the job. They're thinking things through. They're not just taking decisions, shooting from the hip.
The Chinese virus
comes from China.
The United Nations must hold China accountable for their actions.
A chief concern for the Morrison government, navigating tensions with Beijing.
They come to the task realistic about the need to compete with China, but also maybe find places in terms of policy where they can cooperate. Our message to the administration is Beijing will listen if we all work together and act together.
Do you think you can find some common ground on climate change?
I think we've got common ground around investing in clean energy.
But Joe Biden's aggressive climate plan intensifies pressure on Australia to commit to net zero emissions by 2050.
Targets is one thing, but how do we get there? And we want, if possible, to enter into a partnership with them on low emission technologies.
Speaking of partnerships, the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Do you plan to lobby or pitch the Biden administration? How's that going to play out?
Very much so. They've made it clear to us that they want to consider further trade agreements at some point. We want them to be in the Trans-Pacific Partnership because that is the big agreement in the region.
For the former Liberal Party power broker, life in DC with wife Elizabeth and their three children has been a far cry from the usual life of a diplomat. No luncheons, no functions.
When I first arrived, I thought my big challenge was to play golf really well because everybody said you've got to learn to play golf and all the rest of it. But 6 weeks in, all of a sudden COVID hit and the embassy went into lockdown. And one of our biggest challenges was the consular workload that came from that, trying to help as many Australians back as possible. And we're still trying to do whatever we can. I read personal letters. I talk to people who've been stranded. When it first hit, I think here in Washington, the feeling was, is there a trade-off here between locking down the economy and dealing with this health crisis? I'm hoping with a new administration that COVID-19 is prioritised to be sorted out, because without that, there won't be a sustainable economic recovery here.
Planning is underway for President Biden to visit Australia later this year, something his predecessor never did. And like everything in the capital this week, Australia Day celebrations have been scaled right back.
We'll probably have some sort of barbecue and I'll pretend that I'm cooking and all the rest of it.
In Washington DC, Amelia Adams, Nine News.
Josh Frydenberg has hit out at Google after it threatened to withdraw its search engine from Australia. Tech giants are against the proposed reforms, which would see them pay news outlets for using their content.
It seems that the digital giants, I think, did themselves a big disservice last week.
The Treasurer says in his view the giants will end up paying for original content. Snap COVID restrictions could be imposed over the ditch after the discovery of New Zealand's first community case in 3 months. The positive test came from a 56-year-old woman who just left hotel quarantine after returning from overseas. At least four close contacts have been identified, with the woman visiting 30 different locations while infectious. Drug kingpin Tsai Chi Lop has been arrested at an airport in Amsterdam, nicknamed Asia's El Chapo. is one of the world's most wanted fugitives. The AFP tracked the Chinese-born Canadian national since at least 2008, suspecting his involvement in multi-billion dollar drug importations into Australia. Australia is seeking to extradite the 57-year-old, claiming his syndicate is responsible for 70% of narcotics entering the country. Lockdowns and isolation have helped fuel a competition boom in Australian speed cubing. Fiercely competitive and mentally challenging, more and more people are racing against the clock to solve Rubik's Cubes.
Welcome to speed cubing. It's a competitive sport, the aim to solve a Rubik's Cube as quickly as possible, and it's serious stuff.
I wanted to get PBs, sub 20s, all that. In competition, my Rubik's Cube record is around 16 seconds.
This is the Melbourne Summer Open Rubik's Cube Championships.
To get to this level, people are putting lots of time in, especially over quarantine. They would put hours a day practicing.
Here, more than 200 speed cubers are fiercely twisting and turning, including 6-year-old Lincoln.
How long have you been speed cubing for?
A few months.
He can solve a Rubik's Cube in less than 20 seconds.
And go.
Then there's
Felix Zemdegs. Felix
Zemdegs. Please welcome Felix Zemdegs. Come on, Felix.
The Melbourne-based former world champion proving to be quite the celebrity after completing the puzzle in 4.2 seconds.
When you're solving it, you're not really thinking about anything at all. You're kind of just using your muscle memory, and you've done it so many times that it's kind of second nature.
More than 450 million Rubik's Cubes have been sold around the world, making it one of the most recognisable puzzles ever made. Speed cubing is growing rapidly in popularity. There's even a movie focusing on the sport. Netflix's Speed Cubers gives an inside look at the intense sport and its competitors. These young cubers, no doubt, drawing inspiration.
Very, very addicted.
Maggie Rayworth, Nine News.
Very impressive. Still ahead, we take a look back at the biggest ever Australia Day celebrations. Plus, quit the chatter, a desperate order as COVID case numbers spiral out of control in France. And just how much did the most expensive coin ever auctioned sell for? But first, here's Paddy Sweeney with sport. Paddy, a dream debut for a Wildcats import.
It certainly was, Jerry. They're only fresh out of quarantine, but no signs of rust from the defending champions. Jumping John over the moon with his statement-making start. Officials swing in more changes for quarantine tennis stars, and the Scorchers cling on to a home final. Tennis officials have added another tournament to help those in quarantine better prepare for the Australian Open. There will now be a new event for the 28 women in hotel lockdown, while the ATP Cup has been pushed back to Tuesday week, meaning there will be 6 leading tournaments before the Grand Slam. West Australian Maddie Inglis now in Melbourne, preparing for her second appearance in the singles draw.
We've had a long time to prep, kind of the last few months, so it's been great up training in Brisbane with all the girls. Feeling fit, feeling ready to go.
The Australian Open begins on February 8. A fierce final quarter has helped the Perth Wildcats to a 12-point win in their season opener against South East Melbourne. John Mooney marking his debut with a double-double, kicking off the Cats' championship defence in style.
7,000 fans back in the jungle, along with a fan favourite. Damian Martin helping hang Perth's 10th banner in the rafters. Teen Luke Travers earning his first start, while the MVP got back to work.
Cotton, top of the key. We pick up from where we left off last season.
Cotton turning creator as new import John Mooney made his presence felt with 7 first quarter rebounds. But with veteran Adam Gibson catching fire, the Phoenix breathed life into the game.
Oh, beautiful, magnificent play making.
Trailing by 6, Mooney went into half time with a bang. Travers rising to level the match.
He looks athletic as he glides down the court.
A Tom Jervis buzzer beater at the final break, putting the Cats up by 3. The captain putting his body on the line before taking charge in attack.
The order was to let it fly, and Jesse does that.
The Phoenix crumbling in the crunch time, Cotton closing it out with 27 points.
It's going up from Bryce, and it's going in from Bryce.
Mooney's 15 rebounds, the most by a Cat on debut.
Man, this place is jumping. This place is crazy. Great environment. Great win, man.
John's not that flashy, but though, rebound and tip dunk in your own three-point attempt is pretty damn good.
The two sides will meet again on Wednesday. Joshua Dorr, Nine News.
The Scorchers have all but clinched a top two spot in a home Big Bash final. Perth moving to the top of the table with last night's 11-run victory over the Stars. It was the Scorchers' eighth win in nine games after losing the first four matches of the tournament.
We felt confident that we were one of the better teams in this competition, and we knew it was a long tournament.
Finals fixtures will be locked in on Tuesday night once all regular season games are complete. The Eagles and Dockers pre-season derby will be played next month, with COVID forcing the AFL to reshape the format. The sides will now meet in an informal practice match, with all AFL teams to play a side from their own state in the last week of February. They'll then all play one official pre-season game in the first week of March. Those fixtures likely to be announced later this week. Manchester City has narrowly avoided a shock FA Cup exit. The Sky Blues leaving it late before finally overcoming fourth-tier side Cheltenham 3-1.
Fireworks temporarily stopping play, Cheltenham trying to put a permanent end to City's hopes. The Sky Blues avoiding an embarrassing exit, piling on three goals in the last 10 minutes.
Jesus! Jesus scores! The flag stayed down!
Southampton advancing at the expense of defending champions Arsenal.
Boyd's gone in!
History for Steph Curry, passing childhood hero Reggie Miller for three-pointers.
Curry is now second all-time.
There he goes.
The 2,561.
It was the Warriors' only highlight, the Jazz claiming their eighth straight win. Ben Simmons with 20 points, 9 rebounds and 7 assists in the 76ers' victory over Detroit.
Runs up the hook and hits it.
The UFC world has been rocked. Comeback megastar Conor McGregor knocked out by Dustin Poirier. The American ended the fight in the second round, avenging his loss to McGregor in the first encounter in 2014. And a solid start for defending champion Scotty James in the Snowboard Halfpipe World Cup Series. James finishing second in Switzerland. Fellow Aussie Laura Peel also picking up a silver in aerial skiing in Moscow, keeping her on top of the standings after three rounds.
That's all from me in sport, Jez, and I'm not going to ask you your thoughts because we all know them, but John Mooney, super impressive for the first Wildcats today.
So impressive.
Super impressive.
Thanks, Paddy. Thank you. It's been a pleasure. Next, a visual time capsule shows Australia Day commemorations of years gone by. We step back in time to January 26, 1988. And why commuters in France are being told to stop talking on public transport. Welcome back. Let's take a look at the biggest headlines making news in Perth this evening. Relatives of elderly residents at a Netherlands nursing home say management has expanded its probe into serious mistreatment claims. Mark McGowan's told WA's homeless to step up if they want to be given somewhere to live, with only days before taxpayer-funded accommodation runs out. A young mother has been killed in a horror crash in Langford after she was flung out of her vehicle. And Trisha the Elephant has been thrown a jumbo party at Perth Zoo, turning the grand old age of 64 and exceeding her life expectancy by more than a decade. A new Australia Day documentary is being released this week, taking us back to when commemorations were bigger than ever. Cameras across the country captured all 24 hours of the 1988 bicentenary, and as the visual time capsule shows, debate over the day is timeless.
On behalf of the staff at the Better and Brighter Northwest Radio, I'd just like to wish this great nation of ours a happy 200th birthday.
Anyone who is old enough will remember the day.
An historic day for all Australians, so happy birthday, you little devils.
And if you weren't there, well, here's a chance to be immersed in the sights, the sounds and the fashions of 1980s Australia. An era defined by icons such as Hawke and Farnsey.
Couldn't have started off with a better choice for Australia of the year.
It couldn't have been very well.
And visiting guests Charles and Diana.
The princess is looking radiant as always today.
My wife and I are delighted to be able to return to Australia
at this very special time to celebrate with you your nation's bicentennial.
The National Film and Sound Archive has restored this one-hour snapshot captured by dozens of cameras from January 26, 1988.
It also had moments of, sadness in terms of the situation in relation to Indigenous Australia.
Thanks for joining us on that one day in 200 years, wherever you are, by the harbour, in the nick, by the pool, under the weather.
I just love being an Australian, and I love Australia Day, and I just love what the neighbourhood have done and how they've got together with this street party.
It was a time when Australia had a newish national anthem with slightly different words to now. Australia's song. The centrepiece of the day, the reenactment of the First Fleet's arrival in Sydney.
We're being greeted like conquering heroes, and that's a very humbling experience.
But what's clear looking back at events from 33 years ago is that divided views on Australia Day are not new. In the pre-internet era, talkback radio was the most immediate gauge of public opinion.
A sense of national pride, and I think that really this is just a wonderful thing.
Seems to me a lot of empty blowing of bags and carrying on about achieving 200 years of something. What?
And the National Day provoked a strong response from the First Nations people.
More than 10,000 Aborigines will take part in today's official bicentennial protest march.
This is the biggest march in this city that I can remember since the moratorium day. And to people all over the world, when they see their television screens tonight and tomorrow, is that we have survived!
In the end, the Australia Day's documentary is a celebration of how one country can give voice to a range of conflicting views about the value of our National Day, even if we argue amongst ourselves.
Well, I think there's too much money spent on it. I think it could be spent better elsewhere. That's my opinion. But now they've started, we'll go along with it and we'll really enjoy it.
Brett McLeod, Nine News.
Public transport commuters in France have been told to quit the chatter to stop the spread of COVID. The French Academy of Medicine issued the warning, advising people to refrain from talking to each other and on the phone. It comes after the country's health minister urged everyone to wear better quality masks. A single gold coin has been sold for a staggering figure in the US, snapped up for more than $12 million. The extremely rare piece was made by a New York craftsman back in 1787. The Heritage Auction sale result is the most ever paid for a gold coin. Not surprisingly, its new owner wishes to remain anonymous. Elizabeth Creasy is back with weather. Liz, a mild start to the working week.
Well, Jerry, we've got a run of cool days before the heat returns just in time for the weekend. I'll have the forecast next. Welcome back. Today has been one of the coolest days we've had so far this year, and conditions are going to remain like this for the next few days as well. We had a top of just 27 degrees at 11 a.m. after an overnight low of 16, and right now it's hovering around 22 degrees. Turning to the satellite, and that weakening tropical low is making its way towards South Australia, while a trough is generating heatwave conditions through parts of the east coast. So it's going to be hot, humid and wet in Adelaide tomorrow, a top of 32 degrees there. Very hot in Melbourne, 39, but there will be a cool change late in the day, and it will also be sticky in Canberra, 37. Back in WA, conditions are starting to dry off in our north. It will be partly cloudy in Broome tomorrow, 34 degrees, becoming windy in Exmouth and Karratha, and it will be quite hot as well. In the south of the state, Albany and Augusta could pick up a couple of mils of rain tomorrow morning. It will be mostly sunny in Kalgoorlie, 31 degrees there. On the waters around Perth, winds will be southerly all day, up to 25 knots in the afternoon. Seas will be to 1.5 metres and swell to 2. And there will be a little bit of cloud around our suburbs tomorrow, 25 degrees in Swanbourne and Fremantle, and 24 in Rockingham. Room for a nice cool night tonight, with the temperature expected to drop down to about 16 degrees early tomorrow morning, with a top of 26 in the afternoon. Australia Day is looking picture perfect, 15 to 27 degrees, but if you want to go to the beach, hit the water early because the wind will pick up in the afternoon. On Wednesday, we could have our coolest maximum of the month with a top of just 25 degrees forecast. We might even get some light rain from a passing cold front. But from Thursday, we will start to see the more typical summer heat building up again. 33 on Friday, 35 on Saturday, and a hot 36 degrees next Sunday. So it is a nice mild start to the week, but that heat is just around the corner, Jerry.
Loving those low temps. Thank you, Liz. And that is Nine News this Sunday. Thank you for your company. Enjoy your evening. Good night.